right, so today's excitement's going to be all about experiment 20. And as you'll see today, we're going to get both B and C due to some interesting timing issues that we're going to have in the next couple of weeks. So let's get rolling. All right. You guys are so much more awake than you were at 9:30 this morning. That's where I was just going to doze off. All right, so what to expect this week? All right, so this week of Tuesday and Thursday, you're going to be looking at Part B, okay? You also expect the quiz on Part B, okay? Quiz number 4 will be there. Experiment 17 lab reports are due at the beginning of your lab section. One question that I've gotten repeatedly on that one is there an NMR literature spectrum for these products? And to the best of my knowledge, no, there isn't, okay? So you have to use all of your chemical knowledge, your experiment, like your calculated NMR shifts, okay, and your interpretation of the spectra to say, did you get the products or not? Right? Just like real life, you might have trouble finding them. Yeah, yeah.
So we shouldn't use the ones you provided in the PowerPoint?
That is not a literature spectrum, so to speak. You can use that as comparison, sure. But that is that's another student who did it last year or the year before. So if you trust that student in mind, sure, you can compare it to that. But ultimately, using that as a published literature spectrum is a little bit of a stretch. So. Yeah, but if you want to fill that in as your column, you could. Well, one thing I would caution you, I don't know if I went back and double-checked that all of the, I referenced it to TMS, so they might be off by a little bit. But that could work. All right, so anyway, go ahead and feel free to either eliminate that column on your NMR data table or I don't know what you want to do, but stick with calculated and any notes that you have there. All right, any questions as you put the finishing touches on that report? And those of you who are like, this is so last week, I was done with this a week ago, why are you wasting my time, Johnson? Good job. Okay? All right. Other things to note, I'm going to reference this numerous times throughout the course of the hour here. Your experiment 20B worksheet, so you'll be doing 20B in lab this week. Those worksheets will be due on Wednesday of next week after fall break. And part of the excitement there is that the Thursday section will do their lab the next day. Okay? So we need to keep that in mind, that the 20B worksheets for both sections will be due on the Wednesday that you get back from winter break. Okay? All right. And so what we're going to do today is cover actually part B and C. And why we're doing them both will become clear in just a second. Okay? And then next week we'll be doing 20C. Note that we won't have lab lecture next week because of fall break or winter break, excuse me. And we're gonna have to offset labs for a second, okay? Or for 1 week. It might be a little bit more illustrative here if I use the calendar instead. Okay, so next pre-lab will be Monday the 22nd. Okay, looking at the calendar here. Okay, we got today. So we're all doing experiment 20B this week. So this is nice and normal and no big deal. Okay, then we've got winter break. I should put that in capital letters with exclamation points, right? But that's there Monday and Tuesday of next week, so there will be no lab lecture. You will meet in workshop as normal on the 17th, so I'll send that out and make sure that that's clear. Okay, so despite the fact that that's a Monday schedule, okay, head to workshop instead. Okay, if you have a conflict of a class that's meeting, okay, just go to a different workshop. All right, then what happens from there? Okay, so your 20B worksheets are due on the 17th that morning. Okay, you give us all 24 hours to get them back to you. Okay, because those of you who are on Thursday labs, you'll be doing 20C next Thursday, okay, on the 18th. And then we'll follow that up, and Tuesday will follow, so your Tuesday's sections get to learn from all of Thursday's mistakes instead of the reverse that usually happens, okay? And so then that way, hopefully everything will be ironed out for you folks on Tuesday. And the reason for this, rather than just taking the full week off, is that the 25th is CIS. Okay, so it's in a weird, it's supposed to be the fall and whatever else. So anyway, it's Thursday of that week. So there are no classes meeting that week. So kind of keep that in mind. Okay. So yeah, everything gets jumbled for a week. I've posted this up on Moodle, so if you have any questions on that. Okay. All right, and then, okay, because there's just not enough excitement, we will have lab lecture on the 22nd. I'll touch on experiment 20C a little bit more, just as a recap, because I know you'll forget everything I talk about today in 2 weeks. Okay, so I'll talk a little bit about that here, and then ultimately, and then we'll prep for the lab final a little bit. Okay, and then the lab final itself will be on the 29th. Okay, I'll give you some practice exams to look at from last year. Okay, I will probably make those available after winter break. If I give them to you now, you'll lose them all by then anyway. Okay. So ultimately, lab lecture there on the 22nd, and then keep in mind that the final is there on February 29th. Okay. And then after that, then let's see, experiment 20 reports, the overall report for everything will be due on March 4th. Okay. And again, I'm going to remind you of all of these, so don't worry. Okay. And then also, those of you who may be very, very happy either way to be checking out of organic and leaving it in the dust, and also to start 256B. Okay. Again, there's still time to go back and forth. If you want into 256B, just let your lab instructor know, let me know, and we can make that happen for you. If you want out of 256B, I will, you know, sign your sheet and let that happen and probably heckle you on your way out. Okay, but I understand. Okay, so let me know if you want to make any changes there. Otherwise, the plan is that we will check out there, and the folks who are doing 256B will then go into doing some library, how to research, get some, you know, electronic resources and things like that. Okay. All right, so there's the schedule that's coming up for the next few weeks. It's a little bit crazy and twisted and so on, and I figured this might help out. Anybody have any questions with that? Okay, if you want to look back at this later, it is up as a separate file up on the Moodle sheet as lab schedule or something like that. So take a look. Okay, so for today, for this week, all right, back to what we were doing before about making this model library. Okay, so everybody now has a phenol in hand, and we're going to do the second step now of making this library. So just as a recap, last time we used three different alcohols, did the Fischer esterification reaction. Okay, so you all started with the para-hydroxybenzoic acid. Okay, did the Fischer esterification reaction. We've got three separate esters that we've formed. Okay, from all the spectra that I've seen, they look like they're, you know, fantastic. Okay, so hopefully everything's working really well there. Okay, now this week what we're going to do is make the variety of esters on the other side. Okay, so we're going to take that phenol that we all have. Okay, those of you who are still in the process of working up your spectra for this, okay, note that that phenol may or may not show up cleanly on your NMR. Okay, so it depends on it, so don't worry if you can't see it. Okay, but you all have it whether you see it or not. Ultimately, what we're going to do this week then is turn that phenol into an ester. Okay, and so this is going to be a different reaction than we did before. Okay, this time, rather than starting with the carboxylic acid and converting that, we're taking a phenol and then essentially adding the carbonyl to it. Okay, so we'll talk about this reaction here in a little bit more detail here in just a second. All right, and so this is how this reaction ultimately works. Okay, so we've got our starting ester compound. We have that free phenol there. What we're going to do is we're going to treat it with an acid chloride, is the general name for that functional group, carbonyl with a chloride attached to it. Those are very, very reactive. We'll talk more about the chemistry of these in lecture in a couple of weeks. Okay, and we'd run these reactions in the presence of pyridine. Ultimately, if you look at the byproduct of this reaction, you trace everything out, the byproduct is HCl. Okay, so then rather than gassing you and your lab mate and everything else, what we do is put a little pyridine in there that sops that up. Okay? And then we don't have to worry about the HCl causing all sorts of problems. Okay? All right, how this reaction works. Okay, once again, this is all up on Moodle, so I'm going to move relatively quickly since we have both sides. So if you don't, you know, scratch it all down, you can sit and click through the PowerPoint on your own. Okay, ultimately, this acts as a nucleophile. It comes in and attacks that carbonyl. That's a very electrophilic carbonyl. Okay, because of that acid chloride, those are very reactive species. Okay, so that comes in, kicks those electrons up. Okay, this is kind of old hat. You've seen a lot of this already. Okay, so you get that negative charge up here. Okay, and then you have a nice leaving group there. Okay, so ultimately what happens, kind of simultaneously ultimately, is this attack on there. You get deprotonation of that proton by the pyridine, and this kicks down and kicks that out. Okay, all of these, to be honest, can happen in kind of, you can write this in about three different orders. Those are the three major steps that happen. Nucleophile attack to make a tetrahedral intermediate. Okay? Electrons kick down and kick out the chloride, and that hydrogen gets removed. Okay? Depending on which resource you look at, you can see those written in different ways. Okay? This is the way that it is in the lab manual, and I think McMurray has it this way as well. So ultimately, we get the attack, make the tetrahedral intermediate, electrons kick down, kick off that really good leaving group. Okay, we make this intermediate here that then gets deprotonated by the pyridine to make your final product. This reaction is really fast. No worries about super long refluxes or anything like that because of the fact that this acid chloride is a very electrophilic species, very reactive. All right. Note that the byproduct in this case is this pyridinium complex, and then the chloride, the Cl- is also a byproduct just balance everything out. All right. Some of the things just in general about this, if you have bulky substrates, they go more slowly. Okay, so if you do happen to have, like on this side, if that's a T-butyl, for example, group on that acid chloride is going to go more slowly just because it is a nucleophilic attack. Okay. And one other thing worth noting is we have a non-nucleophilic base. Okay, so pyridine is a nice, it's a basic species, but it's not a nucleophile. Okay? And the reason it's not a nucleophile is this is already, you know, it's a relatively stabilized species. That lone pair is not liable to go in there and attack. And so as a result, all it does is it neutralizes the HCl and doesn't actually attack the acid chloride itself. Okay, that's a very, very important part. If you do this with something like diethylamine or something like that, you get that amide instead of the desired product. It doesn't react to the alcohol. Okay, so it's important to use a non-nucleophilic base when you do this reaction. All right, any questions with the general mechanism and how this thing works? Awesome. All right. Okay, some of the things that you really want to know when you're doing this reaction. Okay, the names of these compounds, because they're acid chlorides, okay, one thing to keep in mind is, so when you look at that methyl or the ethyl, you know, do I have one carbon, two carbon, three carbons? That's in addition to the actual carbonyl carbon. Okay, so if you have like R equals methyl is yours, like if you look at the old technician number and you see that there, you're actually using the two carbon acid chloride. Okay, so to kind of keep that in mind, so it's the R group that is either one, two, or three carbons with the carbonyl already present. Okay? The names for each of these, okay, are a little bit goofy. Okay, so you have the acetyl chloride if you've got one, propionyl chloride for two, and butyryl chloride if you've got three. Okay, so kind of keep those in mind. Hopefully you can tell the acetyl is always that special kind of two-carbon group when there's just one carbon in addition to the carbonyl, sort of like acetic acid. And then these, the prop and the bute here, actually make some sense with the terms of the number of carbons. Okay, so be sure you grab the right one when you're doing these reactions. Okay, some of the things to kind of keep in mind. Okay, acid chlorides are lacquerators. Okay, while it might be tempting to do so, don't stick your nose in your flask and take a big whiff. Okay, they smell strongly. They're water sensitive. Okay, that acid chloride, just like this OH here, can go in and attack and make an ester. Okay, water can do that same thing. So if you get water in there, it will just make the carboxylic acid in the same way. So you want to be a little careful. We're not going to take any major precautions, okay, to avoid the addition of water in there. Just be sure your flask is dry before you run this reaction. Okay. All right. In particular, those of you who are lucky enough to use butyric acid or the butyryl chloride, that compound really can smell. Okay. So we're going to take some various precautions over the course of this next lab here. The butyric acid, so if you have the acid chloride, it gets a little water in it, okay, you make some butyric acid, it smells like rancid butter, okay? You know, since I'm sure you churn all your own butter at home and know exactly what that smells like, I'll just tell you it smells really bad, okay? And you'll notice it, because those of you who are lucky enough to do it, as good as your technique is, there's a little bit that happens, it'll get exposed to the air, and you will smell it, okay? So, wear gloves when you use these things, you don't want your hands to smell like rancid butter all day, you'll be the most popular person on campus. Okay, but we'll tell you some other things to do, especially with the waste when you're done. Because that's one thing that, so just sort of keep in mind is a general, you know, things when you're out there to being a chemist, okay, is you think about these things and you think about taking care as you're setting your reaction up. Everything got set up and it's off and running and everything is good now. And then you sort of don't care anymore, not realizing that your gloves might have some on it, the filter paper that you use, your flask still has some remnants of it, your graduated cylinder. And then you get careless with those, and then it stinks after the fact, okay? So just be aware that if you're using it, there's some special precautions. Okay? In addition, pyridine is toxic and has a stench. It's not nearly as bad as the butyric acid, okay, but you will smell it, okay? So this is another one. Be sure you wear gloves while handling it, okay? And of course, don't drink the chemicals, okay? So just work on it. All right. It's good to keep in mind throughout this to probably keep gloves on through pretty much the entire process. One other thing I will remind you is if you are wearing gloves, anytime you leave that lab area, take them off. Okay, if you're going to do an IR or going to, you know, get something out of the wooden shelves or the ice machine or something, get those gloves off. Okay, if you use a couple of pairs of gloves, it's totally fine. Much better than spreading those chemicals all over. All right, so when you're getting set with your pre-lab. Couple of things to know. You should use between 1.5 and 2 grams of experiment 20A product. Okay? That depends how much you have left. If you know that you have, you know, 1.7 grams left in that round bottom flask that's in your drawer right now, use 1.7 grams and your life is easy. Use that same flask and it's even easier. Okay, you won't even have to weigh it out or anything. Okay, if you've got it somewhere else, kind of, if you've got a little bit extra, you might want to use a little less than that. Whatever. It doesn't matter how much you use, just use between 1.5 and 2 grams. If you need extra, if you don't have that much, we do have some extra stockpiles around. Okay, so just let your lab prof know. Determine the amount you'll use, okay, based on whatever you got for 20A. Calculate the number of moles that you have. Okay, so that's easy enough. Then what you need to do is determine how much pyridine you need. Okay, ultimately you need 1.7 equivalents of pyridine. Okay, and so the way to figure that out is figure out how many moles of your starting material you're going to use. Okay, multiply that times 1.7, then times the weight of pyridine, times the density of pyridine, and that will tell you how much pyridine you're going to need. Okay, so calculate that, the volume of pyridine you need. Pyridine is a liquid, so it's going to be a lot easier to measure that out in terms of volume than it is mass. Okay. Now you do the same thing with the acid chloride. Okay, there's a slight excess of 1.5 times excess of the acid chloride in this reaction. So you want to do the same thing, figure out how much of the starting material that you need, multiply that times 1.5, and then determine how much acid chloride you need. Again, determine that in volume. Okay, you're going to go up, fill your graduated cylinder. Actually, in this case, we'll do a syringe for the acid chloride. Okay? But you'll need to know how much you need for that reaction. Okay, again, in volumes, because it's really hard to get masses in syringes. All right, and so those should both be done before you get there. Okay, if you happen to have to change it when you're there, that should be fine. You can just change the ratios together. Okay, not a big deal. But ultimately, try, you know, it's easiest if you give it a pretty good feel for what you're going to use, and then calculate accordingly. All right, the reaction setup is going to look like this. Okay, so some other ideas. You want to use dry ether for the reaction. Okay, so not from the red can. Okay, we want it dry, and the reason for the dry is the fact so it doesn't react with the, so the water doesn't react with the acid chloride. Okay, so we use the dry ether. Okay, you're going to set it up in a round bottom flask like this. Okay, you will then use a septum. So you see there's that little kind of white thing on the top? That's a rubber, it's essentially a rubber plug that you put in the top of your reaction. Okay, you get your pyridine in there, you get your substrate in there, you get your ether in there, then you put the septum on. Okay, and you'll get one needle to use as a vent needle. Okay, and then ultimately with this other one, either the professor or the TA will measure out how much acid chloride you need, okay, in a syringe, and then you just put that right through the middle of the septum. So you'll get a little bit more idea of that when you actually see it in front of you during your lab. Okay, we'll fill the acid chloride syringe for you and put it through the septum. Okay, and ultimately you're going to add that slowly over the course of several minutes. If it doesn't stir well, because what ends up happening is in this reaction you create some salts at the end, that pyridinium salt and things like that. What can happen is these reactions can go fast enough that you can make so much salt that it isn't dissolved and it gets like a big sludge in your flask. Okay. In that case, you can add some more ether and then continue. Okay. I think that we have it right now. We've changed the procedure a little bit over the last couple of years. There should be enough ether present that we won't have this problem. Okay. But if your stir bar stops stirring, okay, during the process of the addition, okay, let us know and we'll kind of help you through the process of adding more ether. Okay. All right. Any questions so far in terms of setting this thing up? Okay, the main thing, you'll kind of walk through that when you get there. The main thing is to have those pre-lab calculations done so you know how much pyridine you're going to need and how much acid chloride you're going to need. All right. Okay, then you ultimately stir a warm water bath for 15 minutes, and that's it. Sure beats a 3-hour reflux. Okay? All right, how you work this up. Okay, so you remove the needles and the septum. Okay, I'll tell you about the cleanup procedure here in a second. Okay, ultimately you add ether. Okay, this time we use red can ether. Why is it okay to use red can ether now when it wasn't before? Okay, the reaction's done. If there is any of the acid chloride left, we're just going to quench it anyway because you're going to put in aqueous sodium chloride solution. So no reason to use nice, special, clean, dry ether when you're just going to dump water in it anyway. Okay. All right, if there happens to be any solid, you can go ahead and kind of smash that up, and then you put this mixture in your SEP funnel. Okay, so you're going to have ether plus your ether that you started with in the reaction, and you're going to have a little bit of an aqueous layer in there. Put it into the SEP funnel, and we can separate those. And then now there's a sequence of washes again, like we did before. You can wash with acid, and wash with base. Note that I say be quick. Okay, what you don't want to do is get your 10 mils of the 2 molar sodium hydroxide, put it in your SEP funnel, shake it up, and then go talk to your friend about whatever's going on this weekend or whatever. Because what happens is that can hydrolyze your ether, okay? Right back to where you, your ester, right back to where you started, okay? And so what you want to do is get that 2 molar sodium hydroxide in there, shake it once or twice, put it back down, and then drain it, okay? So get it out there. It's not a super, super fast reaction, but if you do leave it there for 5 or 10 minutes, it will start hydrolyzing that ester. All right. So once you do that, then you wash it once again with the sodium chloride solution. Okay, and now the rationale for each of these, this can be useful, right? So we wash that first wash with acid. Okay, that's going to get rid of the pyridine. Okay, any residual pyridine that wasn't protonated in the course of the reaction, the HCl will protonate that, it'll dissolve in the aqueous layer, and you'll wash that out. The second step then, with the 2 molar sodium hydroxide, it'll deprotonate and remove the phenol. Okay, so if you have any unreacted starting material that's still that OH, it'll deprotonate that and that'll go away. It'll also get rid of any acid. So any acid chloride that you have left, once it touches the water, will make the acid chloro. Okay? You hit that acid, it'll make the carboxylic acid. And now the carboxylic acid will get deprotonated by this and that'll get washed out of your reaction. Okay, so you're just kind of washing away your byproducts here sequentially. Okay, and then once again, the sodium chloride helps remove any residual base you might have in there and also helps you get rid of the water, helps dry out your product again. Okay, great to know what each of those steps does. All right, and then after that, okay, you can take a TLC. So now at this point, you have a TLC that you've set aside, at least your TLC standard for 20A. You've now got 20B that's something different. Run the two of them up a TLC plate. Okay, really what you're looking for is that they're not the same thing, right? If you have the same thing now that you did at the start of lab or your end of lab last week, it's trouble, right? Okay, you want something different. That's really ultimately what you want to see, is you want to see your hydroxy ester, your product from last week on one, and then your diester on the other lane here. Okay, so you want those two things to be different. Okay, if you still see 20A product in there, you're going to have to repeat the base and the sodium chloride washes. Okay, so you basically go back to this step, continue that one again, and go through. Okay? Typically, if you're quick enough here, you'll get through and you won't have a problem of having to do that multiple times. Right? And ask your lab prof if you have any questions. Sometimes there's just a faint little hue of this 20A product left. You know, and you can get by with it. If it's a really dark spot, you definitely have to repeat the washes. Okay. All right, questions so far? All right, and so you take this TLC of the crude product from that ether solution that you have just used right here. Okay. Once it looks good, then you can go ahead and rotovap it. Okay. Dry over mag sulfate, okay, then rotovap and then HYVAC. You ultimately want to do the TLC first before you dry it and rotovap it and HYVAC it, because then if you do all of those things and then look at it and still see 20A, now you have to go back and repeat all of those steps. Okay, so you want to do that TLC after you've washed it with everything, but before you go ahead and dry and fill it. Okay. All right, so this is the same process we've done before. You dry it, again, that tear flask could be your friend. Okay, be sure you do that beforehand, saves you some time. Okay, then rotovap, HYVAC. And kind of the same thing that we've done before now, at this point, you set aside some for your TLC standard. Okay, so now you'll have two of them in those little vials, one from 20A, this one now from 20B. Both of these will come into play next week for 20C, you know, so you can tell what product you make when you do some hydrolysis. Okay. All right, we'll take an IR and an NMR as we've done before. You get to interpret those. So now instead of having one ester present, you're gonna have two different groups there. Okay, so all sorts of fun that go together with that. Okay. And then again, you know, be sure you store that sample in a safe place, because that's what we're going to use then in 20C. And of course, be sure to label things carefully, because all of these kind of look the same. All right? Okay, any questions with that procedure? Hopefully that's all pretty straightforward in the lab manual thing. All right, what you're going to have to do then by next Wednesday? Oh, before you do that, you're going to have to clean up. See, I almost skipped over this myself. Okay, clean up. This is a like I said, we're a little bit more careful in this case in terms of cleanup. Luckily, those of you with acetyl and propionyl chloride don't have to wash too much. Okay, but these compounds can stink as well. Okay, so what you're gonna wanna do, you're gonna have syringes, needles, and a septum. What you wanna do is rinse all of those with acetone. Okay, probably the easiest thing to do with the syringes is just fill a beaker with some acetone, pull it up into the syringe, squirt it out, pull it up into the syringe, squirt it out. Do that 3 or 4 times, you're done. Okay, that's about it. You'll have 2 needles, one was your vent needle and one was the other one. With the other one, just spray a little acetone right through the needle and that'll be good to go. Okay? There'll be hood containers, okay, for where to put those used needles and used syringes. Okay, so we'll have those all set up for you. Okay? If you happen to have any stinky garbage, if you spill some of it or something like that, have to wipe it out with a paper towel, okay, leave that in your hood. Okay, we'll get a garbage bag that we actually put in your hood that you can stash those. Okay? And then the mag sulfate and any filter paper will have a bucket for waste in that front hood, kind of as we have been doing there. Okay? So that's really nothing too terribly exciting there, just the fact that you want to wash those out before you return them into that front hood, into the used needles bin. Okay, butyryl chloride. All right, you're going to want to be a little bit more careful with this. Okay, you're going to want to wear gloves. Okay, rinse all of your equipment with acetone into a beaker. Okay, so don't put it into your organic waste. Put it into a separate beaker. And what we're going to do with that is especially, so the two of you at a given hood, at least in most labs, I hope, will be both using the butyryl chloride. Okay, so you can use like one big beaker, use that for your waste. So as you do like the syringe wash, like I mentioned with the acetone, put it into one big beaker rather than into the organic waste. Okay. Now with that beaker, when you're done with it, we'll have a TA come around. Okay, a TA, it's not gonna be me. Okay, and then basically we have one waste jug. Okay, that we put all the butyric acid waste into. Okay, so we kind of keep those separate as long as we can. Right? What we will do then is, okay, after you do the acetone, if you rinse the syringes, needles, and septa with bleach and water, so you can do the same thing. Put a little beaker that has some bleach in it. Okay, pull the bleach up in the syringe, squirt it out, do that a couple times. That helps like oxidize these and kind of deadens the smell a little bit. Okay, that waste of both the bleach, the water, and that acetone after you've done all that can all go down the sink. Once you've done those wash steps, then we can collect those that equipment as well. So the needles and the septa and the syringes and everything else. We'll collect those in the front hood as well, okay? The other thing, anything else that you've used, okay, with the butyryl chloride, so your round bottom flask and things like that, you'll wanna hit those with a little bit of bleach as well. Just to be sure you clean that out. Okay, then hit soap and water like normal, a little bit of acetone, you'll be all good to go. Okay, here's kind of the kicker. Any gloves, paper towels, whatever else that you use, okay, we're gonna give you a special garbage bag that should stay in your hood. Okay, so go ahead and once you're done with everything and you think you're all set, get those gloves off, any paper towels that you use, put those into a garbage bag in the hood. Okay, and what we'll do is we'll seal those garbage bags up before we move them up. Okay, all it takes is one person to walk across the lab with some stuff that hasn't been totally like neutralized, and everybody will know. Okay, so sort of keep that in mind. Okay, when things go well, and to be honest, most of the time they do, you hardly notice it. If you walk by and intend to sort of see what it's all about, you can figure it out. But otherwise, there haven't been any horrific, odoriferous experiences lately. So hopefully, we won't do that this week either. All right, and that's pretty much it in terms of cleaning those things up. Okay. All right, one other note is when you rotovap your butyryl chlorides, be sure you use the hood the rotovap that's in the hood rather than the one that's out in the lab. Okay, that can help a little bit too. But usually by that point, there's really not much concern anymore, but just in case, just to be safe, use the one that's in the hood rather than the one that's out in the lab. All right, questions with any of that? All right, so when you're all set, now we get to the report. All right, so this is the report. Once again, for 20B, this is a worksheet. Very, very similar to what you did this week. Okay, some of the highlights I'll just hit quick. Okay, compare your IR to the starting material. Okay, attach your IR and data table. As we get to more and more complex molecules, the chances are more and more likely that you will not be able to find the literature compound in, say, SDBS or something like that. To be honest, off the top of my head, of the 9 possibilities, I don't know which ones are available on SDBS or not. Okay, you can kind of do a redundant search. You can search for the name. I'll give you the names here in just a second. Okay, and you can search for like the formula. And if you don't find it, you don't find it. Okay, so don't be too surprised if you can't. Okay, some of them are available, some of them aren't. And so what we do instead is you compare the IR to the starting material. Because basically that says, I don't know exactly what I made, but I made something different. Okay, that's really the key, that some reaction is happening. Okay, and again, attach your IR and the data table to this report. All right, same thing with the NMR. You've done this before. Okay, label the NMR spectrum, assign the peaks. Okay, and then attach the spectrum to the data table. Okay, if there's any unknowns that you see, if there are little tiny things on the bottom that you have to squint to see, you know, don't feel like you have to label every single little thing. Okay, but if there's anything significant that's in there, go ahead and label what that is. Okay, don't forget some of the very, very common things like the chloroform, the CHCl3, that always shows up at 7.26, give or take a little bit. Okay, some of those you should be familiar with. Okay, but label those as anything that's significant in there. And then finally, the additional part of this one is go ahead and draw your TLC in there. So you'll have a TLC plate of 20A and 20B compounds on it. Okay, so they're a nice little model right there. You can draw what your TLC plate look like, and then calculate the RF. And then finally, is there any reason for you not to continue? And if you say yes there, you're going to have to go to work and figure out what happened and get some new product in there. So. But I'm very, very confident these are all going to work. All right, questions with any of those? And just, again, a reminder, you can figure out times from your lab professor for sure, but ultimately these are going to be due next Wednesday. All right. Questions? Okay, some useful information for you. There's probably too much stuff here to copy down right now. Check out the Moodle site, pull up this PowerPoint, which you're gonna find. Here's all the information you need for each of your reactants. Okay, you can pull it up. If you're really quick, you can do it, but I'm gonna give you about 3 more seconds to do it. Okay, so these are all up online. Pull them up, find which one you need, and figure out your information. Likewise, these are all of your starting materials and your product names. Okay, that can be useful if you want to check out on SDBS. Like I said, some of them are available, some of them aren't. Okay, so if they are available on SDS, it is most likely on these names. Okay, but it is possible that it is something slightly different. So, good luck. Okay, so if you need some help looking at it, let me know. Otherwise, at this point, you need to use your abilities to interpret an NMR spectrum to say, yeah, that's consistent with what I'm expecting. Good and good. Okay, all right. There we go. Now, just for bonus, we get to switch gears. Okay? We're not done yet. Otherwise, just think, if this was a normal like lab lecture, you'd be out of here now. But you don't have to have lab lecture next week, so it's an even trade-off. Okay? All right, I just have a question. How many of you are familiar with the NyQuil challenge? There's some, okay. For those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, don't worry, it's not worth your time. Okay. For those of you who have raised your hand, it's a great job. You're hanging in there if you tried it today. Okay. It's an issue of can you stay awake through lab lecture. Okay. Sometimes the truth is cruel. Okay. But I understand. Okay. So fasten your seatbelts. We're going to go through chapter 20C really quickly. Okay. And if you tried it today, hang in there. You're almost there. Okay. Experiment 20C. Enzymatic hydrolysis. So this is what it all comes down to. Yeah, if you don't know what the challenge is, ask around. You'll figure it out. Okay? You basically take a dose of NyQuil and see if you can stay awake through lab lecture. See if it's not hard enough the way it is. Right? Okay. But we'll do it. That's right. Everybody, shake it off. Okay. Second half. Let's go. Okay. Enzymatic hydrolysis. All right. So here's the deal. Quick little overview. Again, all of this stuff is available online, so I'm not going to go really, really slowly here. Okay, enzymes are the biological catalysts. Okay, ultimately what we want to do here is see, will one of these two enzymes that we're going to use selectively cleave and selectively hydrolyze these esters that we've made? Okay, there's 6 major types of enzymes. Most of the enzymes that you encounter are proteins. Okay, 6 major types, they're all right here. Okay, the one that we're interested in right now is the hydrolases. Okay, so these are the ones that actually make sense. The hydrolases catalyze hydrolysis reactions. Okay, and that's what we're doing today with the enzymatic hydrolysis. Okay? I promise you nobody's going to ask you about all those different types of enzymes. Okay, ultimately, one thing that's worth noting is for reasons that I'll kind of discuss here in a little bit, enzymes reactions, some are very, very generic, and enzymes will react with all sorts of different substrates. Others can be really, really specific. So specific that if you have a methyl group there, it will react like gangbusters, but if you have an ethyl group, all reactivity stops. Okay, so they can be very, very specific. And some of these are really, really interesting and kind of ornate reactions where they can take a specific complex organic molecule and put a chlorine right there. And that's the only place they'll chlorinate one spot and that's it and leave everything else alone. But as soon as you change that molecule by like one carbon, it won't work at all. So it's one of these things that it's a fascinating, you know, how nature's machinery works. It's just amazing. Okay? And so because of the fact that they are these big complex structures, they can have this sort of specificity. Okay? On the other hand, some are very general. Okay, so you just have to kind of test things and find out. All right, so just the kind of general idea. This is actually what the whole protein looks like for the pig liver esterase. Okay, so there are two different enzymes that we're going to use this week. One is orange peel esterase, one is pig liver esterase. In all honesty, the orange peel esterase is really not that well known, so there's not a lot of detail. Okay, pig liver, on the other hand, is very specific. Okay, we know the whole structure of this. How many people have seen like the ribbon structures like this for enzymes or proteins before? Okay, so some of you are roughly familiar. Okay, ultimately what really matters is all these little ribbons that the biochemists just like hatefully ignore. All those are, you know, carbon-carbon-carbon-nitrogen bonds that make this whole molecule. Okay? And it turns out that they have various tertiary and quaternary structure that we'll talk about in probably 6, 7, 8 weeks in organic living. Okay, but ultimately, this is what the enzyme looks like, and the active site is kind of right there towards the middle. There's two different like models for how enzymes work and how they behave with structures. Okay, one is like this lock and key sort of idea, where an enzyme is a very specific, think about it as a lock, and it takes a very, very specific molecular key to fit in there and get the reaction to happen. Okay? So if you look at like this example, biochemists like cartoons. It's one difference between organic chemists and biochemists. Like, things like this don't mean anything to me, but biochemists live for these sorts of things. You see Pac-Man in like every biochem like presentation. All right, anyway, this is like an angry upturned Pac-Man, okay? And there's the substrate. You see how it fits perfectly right in there, and then that kind of completes the structure, and then you get reactivity, okay? If it's a little bit different and say, you know, this green part of the blob over here is a little bigger, then it doesn't fit with the yellow part of the blob, and then it doesn't fit in there, and you don't get any reactivity. Okay? This is all biochemistry by Johnson today, which, yeah, don't tell Picard to a legend or Chase I'm doing this. All right. Okay, so here's the other general idea is kind of an induced fit model, where there is an active site, but what happens is when a substrate comes in, the protein, so the enzyme, can actually kind of move a little bit and modify itself to accept that substrate. Those tend to be a little bit more like versatile in terms of what substrates they react with. Okay? So you can see that there's generally an active site there. When the substrate comes in, okay, the enzyme sort of morphs itself, accepts that substrate, and then you get reactivity. Okay? Which one's right? They kind of both are, to be honest. Some function like this and are very, very specific. Other enzymes function like this and can accept a little bit of it. Okay? All right. So within hydrolysis enzymes, okay, and specifically in the pig liver, there's this triad of three amino acid residues. Okay, an aspartate, a histidine, and a serine triad. These three things come together to allow hydrolysis. What's interesting about it, and kind of the idea of this three-dimensional structure, is these three things are not next to each other in the triad. Okay, so if you look at, this is another way of depicting the pig liver esterase. So if you look at the serine is number 87, the aspartate is 264, and histidine is 286. So they're actually on three very different parts of like the peptide chain, but when it all folds together, they become close enough that the three interact together and work together to get the hydrolysis to work. Okay? So it's really kind of fascinating, it's that three-dimensional aspect of the enzyme. All right, okay, so like I said, they're not adjacent, but they're put in proximity when the thing folds up. Okay, so here's my cartoon drawing of how this enzyme works. So these three residues are in totally different places, right? When it folds up like this, okay, it becomes, you know, it sets up a channel, and then that's where the reactants get recognized, okay? And so anything that goes down that channel and gets into the right spot then can undergo reactivity. Okay? I like to think about enzymes as giant dinosaurs that eat things. Okay? When it comes down there, it reacts with it. Okay? Some dinosaurs are more picky eaters than others. Okay? Some will react with lots of things, other things will be very, very specific.
Don't tell Lebner Chase I said that either.
Okay, so some reactions can be really, really fast. Because all these things line up, they happen really, really fast, so you don't have to go through these high energy intermediates that we do when we just do the basic reactions. They all kind of even out. Okay, so the high activation barriers are lowered and the low kind of low-lying substrates are raised in energy. And so they're all very, very thin, and so they happen really, really fast. Okay? Ultimately, what happens here is if we look at what the actual chemical residues there that are on the ends of these amino acids, okay, I've included them here now. So now when a substrate comes in, comes flying in from the back there, here we go, okay, there's the ester. It comes into proximity now to the active site of this enzyme. Now what's going to happen is it's going to connect itself to the serine residue. Okay? It's a whole series of reactions that happen. So instead of this serine just simply reacting with the ester, like we would see in, say, a chemical reaction, we have this whole sequence of things that happen. It shifts the whole active site just a little bit, and because of this, you know, this O minus here is quenched ultimately to do this whole sequence to attach the ester. Okay? So no big highs and lows in terms of the energy sequence. It all stays pretty close together. All right, so when it does that, it attaches the ester down here. Okay, so now it's basically what's called an activated ester. So it's broken that initial bond, and now it's just hanging out here. Now a water molecule comes in there, okay, it comes flying in, it comes into the channel, and now it can react through essentially exactly the opposite, okay, to now cleave that ester. Okay? And so now in this case, here's the, you know, we had the ester, we broke the initial bond here to make this activated species. Now water comes in, and that basically removes it from the enzyme. Okay, and so now when it comes off, you're going to have this as an OH on the end. That's going to leave out of there, and you'll simply regenerate this initial species that you have that's totally ready for the next equivalent of the ester to come in. Okay? But the key is that that ester that you started with, okay, this generic one I have here with the R and the OR, that has to fit, okay, into this active site in order for this reaction to happen. Okay? And sometimes, depending on what the size of those things are, depending on what enzyme you're using, okay, sometimes a lot of things can fit. It's like the really hungry Tyrannosaurus Rex that will eat any ester that comes close, versus the other one that's very picky that will only work for very specific esters. All right? Does that make sense? I see a couple of heads nodding. Okay, the rest of you, that NyQuil's kicking in. All right. Okay, so what are we doing now? Okay, so in contrast, esters can be hydrolyzed chemically. Okay, either acid or basic conditions. Okay, so this first you can cleave an ester through acidic conditions, which through exactly the reverse of the Fischer esterification that we did last week. So now you start with the ester, you protonate this carbonyl, and now water comes in there, and ultimately you can protonate. Okay, so you can just drive it backwards, put in a little acid catalyst and some water, and you're going to get the carboxylic acid back out. Okay. Also, you can do this under basic conditions. Okay, so we've talked about kind of nucleophilic addition of negatively charged nucleophiles into carbonyls. That's what happens here. Okay, you bring that in, you kick those electrons up, you get this tetrahedral intermediate, and you simply drop that back down and kick off this OR group, and you get the ester, or sorry, the carboxylic acid band. Okay, so they're very relatively simple methods, but some of these intermediates, say like this, that you get there are higher energy than the intermediates that you get in the enzyme. Okay. All right. So when we get down to some nuts and bolts of 20C, this is going to feel weird because we aren't going to do this until after break. So I'll kind of hit some highlights here. What I would suggest is check these out on like Wednesday when you come back from break, and that'll help you when you're prepping for lab on Thursday. Okay. Some little things, we're going to do a small scale on these. We're only going to use between 1 and 200 milligrams of material for the pig liver esterase and between 1 and 3 for the orange peel esterase. Okay? You'll need to scale your other reagents accordingly. Okay, so it gives you a pretty good idea on how to do that in lab. Okay? But small scale here, so you're going to make enough product without a problem to run these reactions. Okay? All right, the TLC will gauge the reaction progress. Okay? So what we're going to do is if you look at the procedure for this, you set up your reaction. After an hour and a half, you take a look to see where it's at. If it's done, you can work it up. If you still have starting material remaining, you go for another hour and a half. We decided we're not going to be that patient this year. Okay. What we're going to do is everybody's going to take a look. You can talk to your lab prof for sure, okay, what he or she says that, you know, they want to do for guidelines. Okay. For my lab section, what we're going to do is after 45 minutes, everybody's going to take a TLC. After an hour and a half, everybody's going to work it up. Okay, and so that way we'll have two time points. It'll be a little bit more compressed, but everybody's going to go to the same length of time. And I think most of the profs are going to do the same thing. So stay tuned for that exactly. What we do, okay, is run TLCs to tell, do we still have our starting material left or not? Once all the starting material is gone, any of the reaction's done. If you still have starting material left, you keep it going. Okay. In this case, the one thing I would note, and hopefully your lab prof will remind you of this, the reaction solvent is water. These are all done in buffers. And so as a result, when you spot your TLC plate, it takes a long time for that water to evaporate before you can run it up the plate. Okay, so be careful of that. If you try to run it up the plate with the water there, now you have this organic solvent that has water in it, and who knows what exactly is going to happen on the plate. So keep that in mind. All right. Okay, experiment 20C workup. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail because you're not going to remember any of this anyway. Okay, so be sure you take a look at this again next week. Okay, same idea. You work it up. Dry the organic, rotovap, high vac. Okay. What you're going to want to do then is take an NMR and an IR. And now the thing to remember is you may have more than one product present. Okay. And so keep in mind that you're going to start with whatever model compound that you made with your R and your R prime. And there are four possible products that come out of this. Right? You could have no reaction at all. Some of you will have no reaction. I hate to tell you this. Okay? No reaction at all. The bonus of having no reaction is there's only one product there at the end, and it's pretty easy to decipher what happened or what didn't happen. Okay? You might get hydrolysis of both. Okay? You might have hydrolysis of one side or the other. Okay? So these are all possibilities. Luckily, okay, 20A product is down here, 20B product is up here, so we know we essentially have quote-unquote literature standards for both of those. You already have NMRs of those, so you can figure out what they are. If you have these two left, you can know one of them is going to have an R group, the other one isn't, and so you should be able to tell the difference between those. Okay? My tip for you, and I'll remind you again a while from now, because it'll be a while before you have the NMRs, is each one is going to have a pair of aromatic doublets. Okay? That's really the key on telling how many of what you have. Yeah, Matt?
So we'd be able to see no reaction at that halfway TLC plate, right?
Yes. Yeah, you should be able to. Yep. All right, and yeah, your TLC will definitely give you a hint on whether you have 20A product, 20B product, or some new thing product. All right, okay, and you'll determine that with NMR. We'll go back to that. Ultimately, what's going to happen is you're going to take your data and report it back to your professor and all your classmates through some form kind of like this, which basically outlines how much of each species you have there at the end. Okay. Your job then ultimately for experiment 20 overall report is to take this data, analyze your results, and then analyze the class's results. Okay? What worked, what didn't work, things like that, and summarize all of them. Alright?
Yeah. Are there like the notebooks
for 20C, yeah. Okay. Yeah. For experiment 20, that'll be the end of the road, you know, for many of you. So yeah, we're gonna collect those notebooks. Many of you will just flip them off as you like go out of organic lab for the last time. Okay, I will go through kind of the analysis and how you go about this again 2 weeks from now. Okay, just to kind of give you a refresher because I know it's a long time from now. Okay, take home messages this week is 20B. Next week Thursday we start 20C. Okay, so take a look at things online. If you have questions, come and find me. Otherwise, thanks for staying awake, and we'll.